All right, Michael. So like I said, we're going to spend all this time trying to unpack this particular equation. And the first thing we need to do is we need to come up with another form of it that we might have some chance of actually understanding, of actually getting through. So I want to use something called Bayes' rule. Do you remember Bayes' rule?
I do.
Okay, what's Bayes' rule?
The man with the Bayes makes the rule. Oh, wait, no, that's the golden rule.
That's
The Bayes rule is it relates, it. I don't know, I think of it as just letting you switch which thing is on which side of the bar.
Okay. So
do you want me to give the whole expression?
Yeah, give me the whole expression.
So if we're going to apply Bayes' rule to the probability of H given D, we can turn it around and make it equal to the probability of D given H. And it would be great if we could just stop with that, but we can't. We have to now kind of put them in the same space. So we multiply by the probability of H, and then we divide by the probability of D. And sometimes that's just a normalization, and we don't have to worry about it too much. But that's Bayes' rule right there.
So this is Bayes' rule, and it actually is really easy to derive. It follows directly from the chain rule in probability theory. Do you think it's worthwhile showing people that, or just they should just?
Well, I mean, you might be able to just see it. Just the thing on top of the normalization, probability of D given H times probability of H. That's actually just the probability of D and H together. Right, so it's the probability of H times the probability of D given H. As you say, it's the chain rule. It's also basically the definition of a conditional probability in conjunctions. And if you move the probability of D over to the left-hand side, you can see we're really just saying the same thing two different ways. It's just the probability of H and D. So then we're done.
No, that's right. So I could write down what you just said and use different letters just to make it more confusing. So you can point out that the probability of A and B by the chain rule is just the probability of A given B times the probability of B. But because order doesn't matter, it's also a case that the probability of A and B is the probability of B given A times the probability of A. And that's just the chain rule. And so if these two quantities are equal to one another, it's exactly what you say. I could say, well, the probability of A given B is just the probability of B given A times the probability of A divided by the probability of B. And that's exactly what we have over here.
Good. So now that we've mastered that, all your Bayes are belong to us.
How long have you been waiting to say that?
Just only about 3 or 4 minutes.
Fair enough. Okay. So we have Bayes' rule. And what's really nice about Bayes' rule is that, well, it's a very simple thing. It's also true. It follows directly from probability theory. But more importantly, for machine learning, it gives us a handle to talk about what it is we're exactly trying to do when we say we're trying to find the most probable hypothesis given the data. So let's just take a moment to think about what all these terms mean. We know what this term here means. It's just the probability of some hypothesis given the data. But what do all these other terms mean? I want to start with this term, the probability of the data. It's really nothing more than your prior belief of seeing some particular set of data. Now, and as you point out, Michael, often this just ends up to be a normalizing term and typically does not matter, though we'll see a couple of cases where it does matter. It helps us to think about a few things. But generally speaking, whatever it is, since the only thing that we care about is the hypothesis and we're trying to find that, the probability of the data doesn't depend on the hypothesis, so typically we ignore it. But it's nice to just be clear about what it means. The other terms are a bit more interesting. They matter a little bit more. This term here, the probability, is the probability of the data given the hypothesis, right?
Which seems like learning backwards.
It does seem like learning backwards, but what's really nice about this quantity is that unlike the other quantity, the probability of the hypothesis given the data, it's actually turns out to be pretty easy to think about the likelihood that we would see some data given that we were in a world where some hypothesis H is true. So there's a little bit of a subtlety there, and let me unpack that subtlety a little bit. So we've been talking about the data as if it's this sort of thing that's floating out in the air, but we know that the data is actually our training data. And it's a set of inputs. And let's just say, for the sake of argument, we're going to do classification learning. It's a set of labels that are associated with those inputs. So just to drive the point home, I'm going to call those D's, little d's. And so our data is made up of a bunch of these training examples. And these training examples are whatever input that we get, coming from a teacher, coming from ourselves, coming from nature, coming from somewhere, and the associated label that goes along with them. So when you talk about the probability of the data given the hypothesis, what you're talking about, well, what's the likelihood that given that I've got all of these XIs and given that I'm living in a world where this particular hypothesis is true, that I would see these particular labels? Does that make sense, Michael?
I see. Yeah. So I could imagine a more complicated kind of notation here where we're kind of accepting the X's as given.
Yep.
But the labels is what we're actually, I see. Yeah, the labels are what we're actually saying is something that we want to assign probability to.
Right. So it's not really that the X's matter in the sense that, you know, we're trying to understand those. What really matters is the labels that are associated with them. And we'll see an example of that in a moment. But I just wanted to make certain that you get this subtlety.
So in a sense, then I guess you're saying that the probability of D given H component or quantity is really like running the hypothesis. It's like labeling the data.
Okay, Michael, just to make certain we get this, let's imagine we're in a universe where the following hypothesis is true. It returns true in exactly the cases where some input number X is greater than or equal to 10, and it returns false otherwise. Okay?
Yep.
Okay, so here's a question for you. Let's say that our data was made up of exactly one point, and that value set X equal to 7, okay? What is the probability that the label associated with 7 would be true?
Huh. So you're saying we're in a world where H is holding, and that H is what's being used to generate labels, so it wouldn't do that, right? So the probability ought to be 0.
That's exactly right. And what's the probability that it would be false?
1 minus 0, which we'll call 1.
Which we'll call 1. That's exactly right. So it's just that simple, that the probability of the data given the hypothesis is really about, given a set of X's, what's the probability that I would see some particular label? Now, what's nice about that, is, as you point out, is that it's as if we're running the hypothesis. Well, given a hypothesis, it's really easy, or at least it's easier usually, to compute the probability of us seeing some label. So this quantity is a lot easier to figure out than the original quantity that we're looking for, the probability of the hypothesis given the data.
Yeah, I could see that. It's sort of reminding me a little bit of the version space, but I can't quite crystallize what the connection is.
Well, it's good you bring that up, because I think in a couple of seconds I'll give you an example that might really help you to see that. Okay?
Okay.